بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى من والاه. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Welcome to another episode, if you will, of Jum'ah Gems. That's the first time I've ever called it an episode. I don't know where that word came from. I didn't mean to use that word. But another session of Jum'ah Gems. I hope I never call it an episode again in my life. But I hope you all are doing well. I'm sending my prayers your way and my love your way. I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is protecting you and your families, and may He shelter you with His graceful protection in these trying times, and give you the full benefit of seclusion, for seclusion brings great spiritual openings, as we discussed in a previous session. Alhamdulillah. So today I just want to reflect on the days of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَذَكِّرْهُمْ بِأَيَّامِ اللَّهِ, and remind them of the days of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in His majestic book, وَذَكِّرْهُمْ بِأَيَّامِ اللَّهِ, and remind them of the days of Allah. We are in the days of Sha'ban, and we just passed a couple days ago the midway point of Sha'ban, which is a special night according to a few hadith, two of which really have the authenticity that is required for us to know that this is not a night to neglect whatsoever. And we spoke about that on the night of the 15th of Sha'ban. You can check out that video. It was just a couple nights ago. And so I wanted to speak about these months in which we find ourselves as we prepare ourselves for the greatest month of all, the month of Ramadan. And before the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the year of his fifth grandfather, right? If you go back to through the Prophet's lineage, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he is Muhammad ibn Abdullah ibn Abd al-Muttalib ibn Abd Manaf ibn Qusay ibn Kilab ibn Murra, and this Kilab ibn Murra, he is his fifth grandfather. In the time of his fifth grandfather, and the historians say around the year 412, which is Allahu A'lam, Allah knows best if it was really 412 or not, because they were not so precise in keeping their dates, right? But five generations, or you know, the fifth great grandfather of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Arabs decided to rename all of the months in order to get all of these months as common, give all of these months a common name to which all of the tribes could subscribe or ascribe. And so these months, right, they had, there were 12 months, obviously, they knew that there were 12 months, and they had different names in Jahiliyyah. And then those names got changed in the time of Kilab ibn Murra, the Prophet's fifth great-grandfather. So this is important for us because these are the days of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And by looking at the names of the months that they agreed upon, all of that obviously was part of the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it just so happens that there is great spiritual benefit to actually studying what the names were and what the names have become, by way of metaphor, if you will, if you will humor me so much. So these 4 months, Rajab, Sha'ban, Ramadan, and Shawwal, right? These 4 months that are in succession. And we find ourselves now in the second of those 4 months, right? Rajab, Sha'ban, we are in Sha'ban now. In the Jahili time, they were called Al-Asam. Rajab was called Al-Asam, Sha'ban was called Adil, Ramadan was called Natiq, and Shawwal was called Wa'il, right? And I may just add that in the comments a little later on, inshallah, after I'm done with this reflection. So if we look at these 4 months, Rajab first, it was called Al-Asam, and Al-Asam means that which is deaf, right? That which is deaf. And the reason the Arabs called it Al-Asam, that which is deaf, is because the month was deaf to hearing any of the clamor of swords, right? Any of the clamor of sorts. And Rajab is actually one of the four months that are sacred. Dhul Qa'dah is the first of these. Dhul Qa'dah, Dhul Hijjah, Al-Muharram, and Rajab. These are the four sacred months in which in the Jahili times, they weren't even, they wouldn't fight in those 4 months, right? So Rajab is still, Rajab was called Al-Asam, right? That which is totally deaf, i.e. deaf to any clamor of swords hitting or of any war cries or anything like that, is totally deaf. And Rajab then, it was called Rajab after that. Al-Asam was changed to Rajab. And Rajab means to be in awe, to be in awe. And there's a great spiritual benefit to that, right? That once there is, you know, to be in awe, you have to turn deaf to the world, right? To be totally in awe of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you have to turn deaf to everything but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they say the first step of the seeker on the path on his path toward Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is silence, right? Silence is the first step, because silence will allow all of the thoughts to fall, right? It will allow the soul to let go of all of its attachments, right? All of the worry and anxiety, to let all of that fall and to fall deaf to everything in the creation, in order to allow the call of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be heard, right? And not muffled out by weapons of mass distraction. So to turn deaf, right? To turn deaf in order to be in awe, right? You know, and this is one of the things that the Prophet ﷺ has said, that it would be one of the signs of the end of time, is that musical instruments would be on people's heads. Right? This is one of the signs of the end of time, that musical instruments would be on people's heads, right? How did he know that? How did the companions understand that? Like, what would there would be the invention of a new musical instrument that people would actually play with their ears or something like that? But that's exactly right. That's exactly right. There is the invention of a new musical instrument that people play with their ears. It's called headphones, right? Headphones. And you literally put it in your ears and you press play, right? And so musical instruments will be on people's heads, is what he said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the more input, right? The more input there is into the soul, into the heart, into the ears of the heart, the more input into the ears of the heart, the less... The more muddled, right, the voice of the heart, the more muddled the voice of the heart. And what is that voice of the heart? That voice of the heart is a constant pulsating beat with the remembrance of its Lord, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So there's contraction and expansion in the heart. Contraction, expansion, contraction, expansion, contraction, expansion. In other words, al-qabid al-basit, al-qabid al-basit, al-qabid al-basit, al-qabid al-basit. The one who constricts and expands, the one who constricts and expands, the constrictor, the expander, right? And this Allah, 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 Allah. The heart is in constant remembrance of its Lord, and that is the insight of Sheikh Hamza Yusuf, may Allah preserve him. So this is the constant remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that's in the heart. So when we turn deaf to all of that, right, we can be in Rajab, in awe of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We can be in Rajab. And Rajab means to be in awe, right? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said that Rajab shahrullah, Rajab is the month of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rajab is the month of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the month to be in total awe of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because you have turned deaf to the entire creation. And then the next month is called Adil. The next month is called Adil. And the Jahili Arabs called that month Adil, that which blames, right? The blameworthy, not the blameworthy, the blamer. Adil is the blamer, the one who casts blame on you, the one who finds fault with you, right? The one who sees your errors and calls you out for it, right? Like Malcolm X said, right? That those whom he felt closest to, those to whom he felt the closest, were those who pulled his coat, right? They pulled his coat, meaning that they if they found him doing anything wrong, they would call him out on it, right? Just being real with him. The adil is the one who finds blame in you, right? And this is something that if it's for a sincere heart, this is what we are seeking in our friendships, right? This is what we are seeking in those people who are around us who can see our faults, to call us out on them so that we can rid ourselves of them, right? And we appreciate them. We appreciate their advice. وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ. And they engage in the mutual consultation of truth and the mutual advice and consultation of truth and impatience. And so that month, Avil, that which finds blame in you, right, was changed to Sha'ban, right, to Sha'ban, which means to shoot, right, to shoot from the earth, right? It's like a shoot coming out of the earth, to sprout from the earth. Shaba is a sprout from the earth. And actually that sprout, with time, with water and sunlight and with cultivation and nourishment, that shoot becomes a branch, which is also a shaba, right? Shaba, that iman is the Prophet ﷺ said that iman had 70 branches, shu'bah, right? And the very least of that is removing something harmful from the way. That's a branch of faith, a shu'bah. And so Sha'ban means to branch out. It starts with a shoot, but it ends up in a branch of a tree that will yield fruit. Right, and so we have these two pairs together, the Asam leading to Rajab and Adil leading to Sha'ban. So Adil, you know, to find fault in you, right, to something that someone or who calls you out for the wrongs in you, right. When we rid ourselves of those wrongs, we begin to grow, right. We begin to grow just like that shoot that pierces out of the earth. It grows, right? It grows. And then we begin to branch out with fruits that are the antithesis of that fault that we let go, right? So when we let go of our faults, we yield fruits, right? Letting go, exactly, letting go of our faults helps us to yield fruits. So when we let go of our faults, we yield those fruits in the month of Sha'ban, which the Prophet ﷺ said was his own month, right? Rajab, Shahrullah, wa Sha'ban, wa Shahri. That Rajab is the month of Allah, and Sha'ban is my month, right? This is the month of growing fruits, right, that will reflect the beauty of the example of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in this month. And part of those fruits means that we ask ourselves, what was the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam doing in his month? So that I may yield those same fruits, right? So I may yield those same fruits. I've already let go of the faults, right, that the blameworthy found in me, so that I may now yield the fruits in the month of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And his fruits was that he fasted almost all of the month. He fasted almost all of the month of Sha'ban. And on the 15th of Sha'ban, the 15th night of Sha'ban, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends on the 15th night of Sha'ban, and this is to be understood as his compassion being that much more accessible to us. Not that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enters into his creation and ascends and descends, no, but this is more metaphorical language, right? This is a language at its highest register, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in order to paint the picture of his compassion being that much more accessible to anyone who asks, right, to anyone who just turns to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's messenger described it in this way, just to enliven us to just turn toward Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so he descends, meaning his compassion is that much more accessible on the 15th night of Sha'ban, and he forgives anyone who his forgiveness is for everyone, except for those who associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or for those who hold grudges against one another, right? So this is the month of bearing fruits for the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and in order to bear those fruits, we must make sure that they are palatable to the Prophet's taste. sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. And that means forgiving people, right? Forgiving people. And we'll talk about that more as we enter into Ramadan. And then the third month, right? The third month, the Arabs used to call it, the Jahilis used to call it Natak, right? Natak. And Natak means to shake and to convulse, right? To convulse. Nataqa, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions it with respect to the mountains, how he causes the mountains to shake. Nataqa, right? So nataqa is to shake and convulse, right? To shake this, to shake the ground under our feet, right? To shake the ground under our feet. And what does that do? It leads us to Ramadan, right? So it's to shake us up out of our heedlessness, to shake us up out of our doubts, to shake the ground under our feet, all of the assurity that we have and the certainty that we have because of our ideologies and our isms and our ideological commitments, and to shake all of that underneath us and to burn it all away in Ramadan. To burn away all of our doubts. That's what Ramadan means. Ramadan means to burn. To burn all of our doubts away. To burn all of our certainties, right? That are placed squarely on the phenomenon here in this creation. To burn away all of our conceptual commitments that are other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that are other than submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger. To shake all of that up. Right, to shake us up out of our sleep, and to bring us into a wakefulness and presence with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right, so this pair is to shake and burn, right, to shake and burn. And one of the reasons that they actually called it Ramadan, right, when they called it Ramadan, they did so because they noticed, again, in the time of the Prophet's fifth grandfather, Al-Kilab ibn Murrah, that they noticed that when they were naming the months, right, because they would name them as the month would come in. So as the next month came in, they noticed that this was the hottest month of the year. It's the month in which the camels, the feet of the camels would go callous, right? From how they were being burnt on the desert sand, right? And so that's why they called it Ramadan. Ramadan means to burn, right? And Ramad is ashes. Right, so they called it Ramadan for that reason. It must have been around July or August, right? so all of the sins then of the believer are burned away, right? All of your isms, they're burned away. All of your everything you hung your hat on that was not prophetic guidance, all of that burns away, right? In Ramadan, and Ramadan is the month of forgiveness of sins. So none of those sins are there to meet us anymore. As we enter into the very next month. And the next month is called Shawwal. The Jahili Arabs used to call that month Wa'il. Wa'il, right? And Wu'ul, are strong, noble men. Wu'ul, right? Strong and noble men. And so you have this this incredible meaning now. Because after having burned your sins away, your faith is strengthened, right? Your faith is strengthened, and you are noble. You have ennobled yourself. You have ennobled yourself before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. After having gone through Shahr al-Sabr, the month of patience, Shahr al-Qur'an, the month of the Qur'an, the month of fasting and abstinence, you have now presented yourself before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a noble person, as a person of nobility. Now, and that's what the month used to be called, Wa'il, right? And then the Arabs changed it to Shawwal in the month that they noticed that the udders of camels and the udders of sheep and goats were empty of milk, right? And then shala yashuru means to be empty. And so they were empty of the milk, and their young struggled to find nourishment in that month, right? Because the udders were empty. And such is the affair of the believer. After having gone through Ramadan where his sins are burned away, then he meets Shawwal completely empty, vacant of his sins. empty of his bad habits, empty of his incessant sinning against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, empty of all of that. And he is now able to adorn his soul now. Because there's tahliya before there's tahliya, right? There is an emptying out that must precede an adornment. And so if we want to embellish and adorn adornment, if we want to adorn truly our hearts with the fruits of faith, then we must relinquish all of what is suppressing that. All of what is preventing and delaying and postponing that, we must be able to turn our backs against all of that, reorient ourselves, and to expose ourselves to the gentle breezes of our Lord as they come upon us. And so this is the month of Sha'ban. These are still the days of Allah. We have just passed the halfway point of the month, and this is where it intensifies even more now, because Ramadan is coming. Ramadan is coming. Ramadan is nearing, and its approach. You can sense its approach in the air. Allahumma barik lana fi Rajab wa Sha'ban wa balighna Ramadan. O Allah, bless us in Rajab and Sha'ban and carry us forth into Ramadan. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi taala wa barakatuh.